G'day everyone, I'm Nathan Hobe, and I make the Godot Dialogue Manager add-on, and in this video I'm going to show you the C# side of things to help you get dialogue into your C# Godot game. Let's get started. For this video I'm using the mono build of Godot version 4.2.1 stable, and for Dialogue Manager I'm using 2.33.1. Now, Dialogue Manager works in the non-mono version of Godot as well, but for this video, I'm just doing C# stuff, so I have the mono build. Let's start by just having a look at the project running. So we have a character we can control. We can interact by pressing spacebar. Have some animations play in between dialogue. And we have some choices. And we have some dialogue that changes depending on our previous choices. And that's pretty much it. So all of the dialogue is in this world dialogue file. You can see it broken into two bits. So there's when you interact with Nathan and when you interact with the apple tree. So handling the interactions and triggering the dialogue is done by these actionable nodes, which are area 2Ds. There's one on Nathan, one on the tree. So the script attached to that is pretty simple. We just give it a dialogue resource and a title to start from. And then we have the using dialogue manager runtime clause here. So therefore we can call dialogue manager directly and the show dialogue balloon method, which we pass in our resource and our start to. So back in Godot here, we can see this actionable. They both actually take in the world.dialog, and they this one starts talking to Nathan because it's on Nathan, and this one has pick apple, which we saw before in the dialog file. Let's have a look inside the player script to see how those actionables are actually actioned. So here we have the player script, and the important stuff here is that we're handling our input inside unhandled input and then processing it in physics process. You can see here we set an input vector based on the actual input and then use that input vector to animate and move and everything here. So the reason we do that is that when the dialogue is visible, it consumes all input that comes through. So the player won't actually have any input if the dialogue balloon is actually showing. So it means your character won't be walking around the screen while you're like interacting with the dialogue. You can see here that we're checking to see if the accept action was just pressed and if the player is nearby to one of those actionable areas. If it is, we set their velocity, or we set their movement back to zero, and we call action on that actionable, which is what we saw before it triggers the dialogue. Something else interesting in here is we have two methods here, look down and reach up, which are used in the dialogue. So when we're interacting with the tree, we do Coco look down. And then Coco says she'll just take one and then she reaches up. So reach up takes a little bit of time to do because it plays an animation. And the way we handle that is we return, we make the method async and return a task. And then we can await on something. So here we're awaiting on that animation to finish. So the way we can call these methods is by calling them on Coco herself. And the way the dialogue can see this is because it's a property of the current scene. So the current scene being world here, so in the script, we just define Coco and load Coco from the node. The dialogue manager has access to anything in the current scene and any auto load, which is also how this apple status works. So apple status is a property on state, and state is an auto load, which just has this apple status string property. Now let's do something new. Let's make this dialogue balloon a little bit more whimsical. But first, I'd like to thank my patrons for making this video possible, especially my Cockatoo patrons, Vanillid, Skia, Mark Lassia, Indie Rex, and Comrade Crunchy, and my Owl patron, Linus Minus. The full files for this project are up on my Patreon, so if you'd like to grab it, as well as all of the other code snippets that I've shared, then become a patron today. Anyhow, let's make this balloon more whimsical. We can start our custom balloon by going to Project, Tools, and Create Copy of Dialogue Example Balloon. It'll ask us where we want to put it. So we'll put it in a dialogue folder. And in here you can see that it's detected we're using C#, so it's made a dialogue balloon.C#. as opposed to a GD script version if we were just using the normal version of Godot. The script that gets attached to this balloon handles all the focus and input stuff for you out of the box, so you won't need to worry too much about that. You only need to make changes to this script if your changes to the balloon warrant script changes, like if you're listening for signals to handle typing beeps and stuff like that, which I'll talk about soon, then you'll need to make changes in here. Apart from that, you probably won't need to touch anything. Most customizations will start with the balloon scene itself anyway. So let's make some changes in here. The theme is all attached to this balloon control node. So you can see just here, has all the theme stuff in it. So we can start by maybe adding a more cartoony font. Here's one I prepared earlier from Google Fonts. Chuck that in, make it a bit bigger. And we can make this panel a bit bigger. Move our responses up. Okay, let's change this balloon to or this dialogue panel to be a bit more rounded. So again, change all the theme stuff in this theme. So we've got our panel here, style box. Make the background color a bit nicer. Like a cream sort of color, I guess. And the border color can be darker cream. And maybe a bit thicker and more rounded. And we'll add some style here for rich text labels. So give them a default color. Okay, it's pretty good. Now let's edit these. They're buttons, so they're a slightly different style. So we go to button. Now buttons have a whole bunch of different things you can change. So normal is the first one we'll change. And we'll make them the same color as our normal panel. Make our border thick like the other one. And make the color the same as that. And our roundedness as well. And we'll make our default color same as this. Okay, now our normal is different to hover. So hover and focus, we probably want to have pretty similar. We can make them a copy of each other. So normal, we'll take a copy first into hover, paste that, but then we'll make it unique so that it doesn't share. If we edit something here, we don't want it to carry over to there. So on hover, make the BG color slightly darker. Not too dark, just enough to see it. That's how we can preview it. Okay, so we're going to change the hover color. Focus and hover, so we'll make them the same as the border. Okay, now we want to copy our, not normal, copy our hover to our focus. And then for our disabled, we'll probably grab normal, copy that into disabled. And make it unique so we can edit it. And so the BG color here, what we might do is just make that more gray maybe, or instead of white, looks kind of turned off there. Cool. And we'll give our disabled color close to that, but more faded out and a bit transparent. Still readable though. Okay, let's see how that looks in the game. So when we make a custom balloon using that tool script, it automatically sets up our runtime balloon to point to that. So when we run the game, it'll now use our custom one automatically. So one last thing we'll change here is I'll add talking sounds. So let's do that. So in our balloon, we'll need an audio stream player with a talking sound, just like a blip or something like that. In our balloon script, we need to make sure the audio stream player is defined and that it's set up in onReady. And then lastly, we connect to the dialog label spoke signal, which gives us the letter spoken, the index of that letter, and then the speed we're currently talking at. So we can do something pretty simple here. You can make this as complicated as you want, but the simple version is if we're not speaking a full stop or a space, then we set the pitch scale in the audio stream player to be a little bit random and then just play the blip sound. So putting it all together, we get this. That's all there is to it. The files for this project are up on my Patreon if you want to have a dig through them there. And if you have any questions, then throw a comment below or jump in my Discord. I'll see you there, and I'll see you here again soon. Bye.